I'm going to take the honors of bringing this young lady
out. Go for it. I'm going to step out of frame.
This young lady is not only a sweet, sweet girl and a gorgeous, gorgeous girl, but one of the best friends you could have. Ladies and gentlemen, Drew Barrymore!
Good afternoon, everybody. For many, the first introduction to Drew Barrymore was in the hit movie E.T. She comes from an acting family and was thrown into Hollywood at a young age. She's battled some demons and came out on top. So today, let's remember Drew Barrymore so far. Welcome to another weekly video and a very special shout out to Krista May. You are truly a rock star. Drew Blythe Barrymore was born into an acting family. So to start, we need to go back. Further back. No, way back. Starting with Maurice Barrymore. Born Herbert Blythe on September 21st, 1849, and passing on March 25th, 1905, he was an Indian-born British stage actor who immigrated to the United States in the late 1800s to begin his career. Maurice got a start on Broadway starring in the play Piquet. After the birth of his children, Lionel, John, and Ethel, Maurice transitioned into vaudeville, where he starred opposite of some of the most famous actresses of that time. In 1901, Maurice was notable for an anti-Semitic monologue on stage. He was later diagnosed with a mental illness, whereafter he was moved to a psychiatric hospital. And after the insistence of his children, due to Maurice's violent and erratic behavior, he was hospitalized where he remained until his death in 1905. His children would also be part of this acting dynasty, such as Lionel Barrymore, a man who continues to live on through his most famous role. Lionel Barrymore was considered one of the greatest Hollywood actors in the 1930s and the 1940s. Lionel was in the first set of Barrymores to come to wide acclaim along with his brother, John, and sister Ethel. Lionel began his stage career in the early 1900s on various Broadway musical shows, starring in the critically acclaimed play The Mummy and the Hummingbird in 1902. In the late 1910s, Lionel began to establish himself as a silent film actor.
There's only one breast that you can surely pin the responsibility of this crime on. Only one! Stephen Ash is guilty and nobody else. Stephen Ash! Your Honor,
I... Getting her start at the same time would be Maurice's daughter, Ethel. Ethel Barrymore is regarded as one of the greatest stage actresses of all time, earning the nickname the First Lady of American Theater. Ethel first appeared on Broadway in 1895, whereafter she was recruited by a troupe in London to perform a tour that gave her great acclaim around the world. Some drawn to her would be Winston Churchill, who actually proposed marriage to her. She continued to have a successful career on stage, though she also occasionally appeared in films and radio broadcasts. Ethel then won the Academy Award for Best Supporting Actress. This was for her role in None But the Lonely Heart in 1944, opposite iconic movie actor Cary Grant. After starring in several film noirs and dramas like The Spiral Staircase and The Paradigm Case, Barrymore even began her own TV series titled The Ethel Barrymore Theater. After passing in 1959, Barrymore was awarded a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame in 1960, along with her brothers.
I'm deeply honored to present this award. I believe that the public, as well as the members of the Academy, realize what miraculous teamwork goes into the making of great motion pictures. The best picture encompasses the finest skills of every craft. The finished product, playing in thousands of theaters, hundreds of thousands of performances, gives millions of people the richest entertainment on earth. Each fine motion picture leaves an indelible mark upon the memories of those who see it. And in time, when the year 1948 is called to mind, among the important and nostalgic memories will be the film chosen here tonight.
One of those brothers would be John Barrymore, and he is the grandfather of Drew Barrymore. John got his start on stage with his parents and siblings back in the 1900s. John found particular acclaim with his stage productions of Shakespeare, where his portrayal of Hamlet gained him notoriety. Barrymore later broke into silent film era, where he starred in popular films like Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. and played Sherlock Holmes in the 1922 Sherlock Holmes movie. Eventually, he earned the nickname The Great Profile. John Barrymore also had a daughter, Diana Barrymore. This made her the aunt of Drew Barrymore, and is someone I think has a striking resemblance to Drew. She starred in a few movies like Eagle Squadron and Nightmare. Diana passed away in 1960 at the young age of just 38. Although this was ruled as a suspected drug overdose, there has been much speculation due to her autopsy revealing no indication of drug overdose or a cause of death. The son of John Barrymore would be John Drew Barrymore Jr. He got his first acting role at age 8 for various Clint Eastwood-style Western movies. Early in his career, John Drew Barrymore continued to star in small roles in films that weren't very successful. This led him into a television career, where he starred in guest roles on different anthology series in the 1950s. Barrymore then shifted back into movies, where he was featured in film noirs like While the City Sleeps, before venturing to Italy, where he made a number of Italian dramas. Barrymore returned to Hollywood after 5 years, where he began another series of television guest star stints. For his contributions to television, John Drew Barrymore has his own star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame.
And with his crazy idea stashed in his lid, he swung over to the royal pad to cut up a few touches with a cool chick, Queen Isabel. Who was a swinger? Belle took a long look at him and said, Christy, what is this jazz you're putting down about our planet being round? She said, everybody hip, did it square? Said, the only thing square about this world are the cats what live in.
And he was the father of Drew Barrymore and passed away in 2004. Drew Barrymore's mom would be Jade Barrymore. John would leave Jade pregnant and single with Drew. Jade Barrymore was born on May 8, 1946, in Brandenburg, Bavaria, Germany. She's an actress and writer known for Searching for Bobby in 2005, and I think her mom would be somewhat of an enabler of the downward spiral for Drew. Drew stated her mom would say things such as, "Do you want to go to school and get bullied all day, or do you want to go to Studio 54? And in case you didn't know, Studio 54 was a very popular nightclub. While Drew and her mom would eventually reconcile, the journey she took was not easy. Drew Blythe Barrymore was born on February 22, 1975 in Culver City, California. Now, normally when making these retrospective type of videos, I like to talk about what life was like for an actor before they began their career. With Drew, this is a bit different since her career started when she was still just a baby.
11 months.
This is a baby, and this is a baby. They both have special nutritional needs. That's why a baby should have his very own baby food, and why a puppy should have his very own puppy food.
Her film debut was in Altered States in 1980, and no one ever played such a lovable kid better than Drew Barrymore. Steven Spielberg spotted her as a natural ham when he picked her at age 6 to portray Gertie in E.T. And her and Steven Spielberg would build a bond at that time. They would go on to be close and probably a closer father figure than her real father.
With a baseball and bat, who with one
After E.T., a slew of roles would come her way, including Irreconcilable Differences, Firestarter, Cat's Eye, and she became Hollywood's go-to for roles that needed a precarious, adorable child. However, that trajectory of success would become skewed when, as Drew states, she had her first drink at age 9. It is said that Drew's mom, Jade, left her to her own devices because, you know, what 9-year-old is not ready to handle Hollywood? Which can be scary enough and, quite frankly, gross at times.
Yeah, but we don't come to the mall a lot. We just come to hang out and see our friends.
Yeah. Exactly.
Totally trust I'm cool to be here every day.
After drinking, Drew said she started liking the feeling and she began smoking marijuana at age 10. And at 12, took up cocaine. And by the time she was 13, was already in more than one rehab program. And it is my firm belief that whatever we go through, whether it be abuse, abandonment, or any other traumatic event, will find a way into your life if not addressed. Facing demons through therapy, God, or what is right for you is necessary to recover.
It was very easy for me to do a lot of what I wanted, you know? And, I really was a party girl, you know? Let's go out tonight, let's sneak out, you know, let's go to the clubs, you know? And it was real easy for me because even though I was younger, it was either good publicity for them or, you know, or another reason, I don't know. But it was just very easy for me to get in. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was so cool then.
It also ran in Drew's family, according to People magazine. Grandfather John Barrymore drank himself to death at age 60. Aunt Diana Barrymore confessed her reckless hunger for booze and drugs in her 1957 bestseller, Too Much Too Soon. And Drew's father, and sometimes actor and poet, John Drew Barrymore, has a history of alcoholism and drug arrest and never really was part of his daughter's life. When she began therapy, therapist Betty Wyman said, "She was so sick, and when I met her, I thought, what a sad kid." Her mother states she had no idea what was going on. She said once Drew turned 9, she had to give her daughter some space. Yeah, no, she's 9. They don't need that much space. Drew says from the time she became famous in E.T., her life got really weird. She said, "One day I was a little girl, and the next day I was being mobbed by people who wanted me to sign an autograph or pose for pictures, who just wanted to touch her. It was frightening." She said she was the 7-year-old girl who was expected to be going on a mature 29. Honestly, if you watch interviews from that time, she really did portray a maturity at such a young age.
Yeah.
Do you know I stay up till a couple of hours to watch your show?
Do you really?
Just because of you.
You're kidding.
No.
Oh, come on now. Are you serious?
Mm-hmm.
Do you understand all of the jokes?
Some of them.
Well, you fit right in.
She then says by the time she was 8.5, she felt like some abnormal crazy girl. She could walk up to the door of any nightclub and they'd say, "Oh, hi, you're that little girl. Come on in." So yes, she was given access to things that she just should not have been. She also goes on to say that she would drink not to have fun. She would do it just to get drunk. Once she got bored with drinking, she started using marijuana. She said she recalls being in a room of adults who were smoking and asked to try some. Their response was, "Sure, isn't it cute? A little girl getting stoned." Not one adult said to this little girl, "No," or "Stop, let's get you some help." And that turned into cocaine use. Drew recalls one night she was in a rage, throwing things at her mom, demanding mom leave the house. A friend came to the door, and they took Drew to rehab. After 12 days, Drew was released from the hospital to film the movie Far From Home in Nevada.
Look, Pinky. I think you're in a lot of trouble, and they know how to handle boys like you. We can just go to your mom.
My mom. My mom will always be there for me.
Peggy.
No.
She spent 12 days in Gerlach, a small town with several bars that she didn't use. Then the movie company moved to Carson City. There, she was able to gamble and went back to the party girl mode. After filming, she returned to Los Angeles where she resented the hospital. She thought to herself, "Where's my fun? I've been missing out on all my friends for such a long time. I have to come back to a hospital? No way." After 6 days in the hospital, Drew, against medical advice, flew to New York City with her mother to audition for a play. She had not had a drink or drugs for about 85 days, but on the plane she says, "I was real afraid of what's going to happen to me." And it did happen. She was in a club waiting for her ex-boyfriend to show up, and in the ladies' room a girl asked, "Do you blow?" Even when she said no, the girl said, "You don't mind if we do it in front of you, do you?" Although she thought it was pretty rude, she's like, "It's okay." A few minutes later, the girl said, "Are you sure you don't want to try any?" And at that moment, Drew says she started to cry. She felt really sad. She looked at her watch and it was 12:37 and she blew her recovery right then and there. She thought, "I was supposed to be home in a few minutes, but I just didn't care. I was tired and I thought, a little Coke will wake you up. Why bother with coffee?" The partying continued until her mother hired private investigators to find Drew and take her back to the hospital. It was at this time where she had to face some things, sharing about her life, her family, and her dad. She's been quoted in saying about her dad that he never lived with us, and when I was little, all my friends had a father, and I thought, I must be some kind of alien because I don't. She goes on to say, "Once when I was really little, he spent the night with us, and the next morning he came into my room. I looked up at him and I said, 'Dad?' And I was really scared he was going to say no, that he was just a friend. But he said, 'Yeah.' I felt so happy thinking he was going to be back in my life, but it never happened. In fact, until she was a little bit older, she woke up every morning hoping he would be there."
"Can I get you a glass of milk, honey?"
"Milk? I'm a Barrymore. Get me a drink and make it a double."
With the encouragement of her friends at the hospital, she got up the courage to call him. For the first time, he said, "I love you, daughter." "And I said, 'I love you too, father.' I laughed and cried at the same time, thinking about what it would be like to have a family. But then she quickly reminded herself that her father is gone from her life and will never be there again."
"Well, the first time I had drank anything was when I was 8.5. Later on, I just have little sips here and there, and then it, you know, like if you can't control it, it progressively gets worse, you know. And fortunately, I was one of those people.
It's hard, but that's the way life is. Much like anything in life, healing is not a direct path. There's ups and downs, so after being released, old habits would return, and she headed back into the center for a three-month stay, and then stayed another 3 months in the home of friend David Crosby, musician of Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young fame. Him and his wife were both survivors of their own harrowing odyssey of alcohol and drug use. On the six-month anniversary of her sobriety, she would relapse. That night, she and her friend got into a car accident. Drew's head broke the windshield, but she was unhurt. Her only concern was the breach of her sobriety might be uncovered. But she was quoted in saying, "But you know what? Addicts are the best manipulators in the world, and we manipulated our way right through it. We high-fived and we were free." She would continue to be placed in rehabilitation hospitals and mental institutions, but after a suicide attempt at age 14 and some more rehabilitation, she sought and was granted legal emancipation from her mother. During these times, Drew continued to work.
Don't you?
Sometimes.
On Arsenio Hall, we see a very reserved, quiet Drew telling her story in person.
At that little girl in the film E.T., or when people look at this little woman now, they probably have a hard time believing that you got lost in alcohol and drug abuse. How did it happen?
Well,
it's a long story.
Yeah, really, it's a very long story. I got to a real bad place in my life, and I wanted to do different things to try and cure it for a long time.
And when you say a bad place, what does that mean? Does the absence of a father have anything to do with it? Does this business and its pressure have anything to do with it?
Yeah, I felt real lonely for a long time. A lot of the feelings that I was going through that brought me down so far was feelings that every person in the whole world goes through. Being lonely, being depressed, having resentments against certain things that's gone on in your life. I didn't do the right things to take care of it, and it got way out of control.
She then put out a book called Little Girl Lost, and what a great way to work through things is to bring them to light. As the healing began, she would evolve into what I call the flower child years, with a Playboy pictorial and this classic David Letterman birthday surprise.
What?
Hi, Paul. Paul, okay, give me some lips.
Oh, my God.
Regarding the Playboy stint in 1995, director Steven Spielberg, who is also her godfather, gave her a quilt for her 20th birthday with a note that read, "Cover yourself up." Enclosed were copies of her pictures, however, the pictures had been altered by his art department, so that she appeared fully clothed in them. It seemed like Drew was holding in so much for so long, a valve just came open, and this new Drew Barrymore emerged. During this, she continued to work with movies such as Mad Love and Boys on the Side, and getting great acclaim for her role as Amy Fisher in The Amy Fisher Story. Around this time, she would also get married to Jeremy Thomas in February 1994. She fell for the British bartender turned LA bar owner, and they got married in March of 1994, and divorced just 10 months later. Drew says she immediately realized that she had made a grave mistake, claiming she knew the day after that she had a major error and judgment. Drew flew back to the United States following their nuptials to film Boys on the Side. However, Thomas made it clear that despite the distance, the two would speak every day now that they were married. After weeks apart, the duo had decided to go on a vacation to Hawaii for their honeymoon. However, after coming to terms with her situation, Drew decided to go alone. Jeremy says, "I got a phone call from her in Hawaii. She'd gone off on her honeymoon without me." The former bar owner revealed he was completely blindsided by the breakup. However, considering the vast age difference and impromptu wedding, the odds were certainly not in their favor, and the divorce was finalized in 1995, 10 months following the duo's wedding. Other films would come out over the years, and Drew Barrymore's recovery would become more prominent as she began to look more healthy and really hit her stride. She would have one smaller role in the campy Joel Schumacher Batman, not this one, the less worse one. Then another small role at the beginning of a movie would have people really starting paying attention to Drew once again.
Hello?
Why don't you want to talk to me?
Who is this?
You tell me your name, I'll tell you mine.
I don't think so.
What's that noise?
Popcorn.
Making popcorn?
Uh-huh.
I only eat popcorn at the movies.
Well, I'm getting ready to watch a video.
Really? What?
Oh, just some scary movie.
You like scary movies?
Uh-huh.
After that, it seemed like there was no stopping Drew Barrymore. She then partnered with Nancy Juvoven, and they would make a production company called Flower Films. Nancy, aside from being a talented producer, would also go on to marry Jimmy Fallon, host of The Tonight Show, on December 22, 2007. This would also solidify a friendship with Drew and Jimmy. Flower Films' breakthrough movie would be Never Been Kissed.
He grabs the bull by the ball.
You don't think I can grab a bull's balls?
In which Drew Barrymore played an insecure copy editor for the Chicago Sun-Times and a high school student. CNN states, there are two words which describes why this film works. Drew Barrymore. Her comedic timing and willingness to go all out in her quest for a laugh combined to make Never Been Kissed a gratifying movie experience. The film was a commercial success, grossing $84.5 million. The production company would go on to make other big hits, such as Charlie's Angels. At this time, Drew would marry Tom Green. Tom and Drew got together somewhere around 1999. They got engaged in 2000 and tied the knot in 2001. However, Tom filed for divorce in 2001, merely a few months after the marriage, citing irreconcilable differences. They reunited on Drew Barrymore's talk show to talk about each other, life, and marriage. Then would come a few more movies, and then she would marry Will Kopelman. That lasted 4 years. Sources say they had marriage issues for a while. Among their disagreements would include tensions over where to live. Barrymore increasingly was drawn to Los Angeles, and Kopelman preferred New York City. And while she divorced, her life seems full. She has found a best friend in Cameron Diaz, and the two have been very close for many years. Barrymore is also the godmother of Frances Bean Cobain, the daughter of Kurt Cobain and Courtney Love. Drew also has a fashion line called Dear Drew. She also has two daughters, Frankie and Olive. Now, will they continue the Barrymore acting legacy? If they do, I think Drew will have them wait until they're able to handle all that comes with that journey. And she has stated before that no one under 18 should be in acting. Now she has her talk show. This show is exactly what the world needed. Drew, being her authentic self, she opens up personally, connects with her audience, has guests such as the full Charlie's Angels group, nostalgic moments, and just a wonderful watch.
I couldn't begin this journey without two women who have been a part of my heart for over 20 years. We are friends. We are fellow angels. Please welcome my partners in crime and life, Lucy Liu and Cameron Diaz.
Now, while this is obviously not an all-inclusive biography of Drew, she has provided so much joy to millions, and watching her become such an icon has been a joy. So if Drew ever comes across this YouTube video, I want to say thank you for what you have given us then, now, and moving forward. Also, thank you for sticking around. It was a battle with so much more that we probably don't know. You came out on top. She is an actor, producer, CEO, and director, and more importantly, a mom and a friend. Thank you so much for watching. It seems like there's so many things YouTube wants people to do for creators. Like the video, click the bell icon, subscribe, high five your neighbor. For me, all I ask today is that if you like the video, you share it with somebody or somewhere. Until next time, my name is Kevin, and as always, have a wonderful, wonderful day. That's all we have. We have TV shows that kept us up all night. Subscribe to Retro. His children would also be part of this acting dinosaur.